of sign work that I'm working on, kind of in my spare time, but eventually leading towards an event where I'll hopefully be selling some works. And I've been doing it every day and most nights for the past week or so. And I just think that it's such a relaxing kind of process, and also it's a very visual kind of thing that it's quite satisfying to watch. So I thought I would just show you what I do for that process. So yeah, I'll begin. So I started by designing some basic kind of letter shapes. So I won't show you a completed one yet, because I want to kind of surprise you with the final result, I guess. But today I'll be working probably on two at once, because there is some drying time involved. So the first one is this kind of basic letter M. So I use a 5mm graph pad, so it's easier for measuring out the exact widths and distances and angles for the letters. And then what I did in preparation for this video was just trace the lines onto some tracing paper. And I'm just going to take that tape and apply it to the inside of a glass frame. So first, I'm just going to kind of sweep away some flakes that have been left over from when I was working on all the letters yesterday. What I used to do up until last night was I'd kind of blow these flakes onto the ground, and then at the end of it kind of sweep up or hoover away the more. But then I realised that that's kind of missing a really good opportunity, and I'll show you what I mean with that later. So I decided to keep all of these, and they actually come in really handily later on and add a really nice kind of different aesthetic value to the final product. So that's all to the side. And I'm just going to blow away the front of this as well. So these are just basic clip frames. And I figured it's easier to work on a simple kind of frame, because if people were to want to buy the kind of initial product, then it would be difficult to find a frame that is kind of universally liked. So for the most part, I'll leave it quite simple. So then if they decide they want the actual piece inside a frame, then they can find one that matches the size and work with that. So this is a 7x5 frame, but obviously it's not completely even on all sides. But I find that I can just about find the right kind of distribution across this grid on this cutting mat I have. And there's a line on the tracing thing there, so I'm just going to quickly draw that on. I probably would be able to look fine without it, but on it's still at such an early stage, I might as well. Forgive me for working in the day as well. There might be a few more kind of loud noises and sounds of traffic than there usually are at night. I've just found that I've tried to record every night, and by the end of the day, after running errands and everything, I'm usually quite tired. So, it's about 1 grid square. I think, yes, these are centimeters, so it's probably about 1.1 or 2 centimeters away from the edge, and about just over one and a half away from the top and the bottom. So I'm just going to try to kind of line it up as best I can, so that as many of the lines are kind of equal with the lines of the grid as possible. That can be moved a bit closer. I think that's probably about right. I'm just going to tape that down with my Hello Kitty washi tape. And I'm just going to turn it over. And I've found recently, in the last few ones of these that I've done, that it's easiest to just clip it back together to work on. It kind of just gives it a bit of a sturdier feel while I'm painting and gilding. My nails are kind of getting stuck a little bit. These nails are very nice for kind of tapping purposes, but I found that I've had to cancel things like a climbing session because I really can't climb with or do many practical things really. With nails like this. I'm so fortunate because they're so pretty. So, I've used, just before I started filming, I've used methylated spirits on the glass to just clean it of impurities a little. It's probably not perfect anymore, but it'll be fine for working on. I'm gonna have some tea. Okay. So the first colour that I need to mix, I thought that I would use a red variegated leaf. On the plants, I did use red variegated leaf on the outside. But I think what I'll do instead is use it on the inside now. And I think I'll use a kind of toffee brown here in the kind of side shadows, and a darker chocolate brown on the bottom. And maybe slightly different shades just in between those for these two angles here. And for the outside of the M, I think I'll probably try to create a kind of creamy colour. Maybe a little bit of a kind of oaty, kind of pinkish. So, the first one to mix, I think I'll start with the kind of oaty. And then I can always kind of add kind of amounts of brown to work from there. So I'm going to start with some white. And it doesn't take a lot of this paint. This is one-shot paint. So it's a really good quality enamel that is pretty much used universally by songwriters. It's quite expensive, but it's the best kind of brand. There are a few other brands, but it literally says on the tin, Song Painter's One Shot Paint, because it's just kind of regarded as the best. Next, I'm just going to add a tiny touch of yellow and red. I was just thinking maybe a little bit of purple. I kind of plan these kind of colour themes, but I keep it quite kind of loose because I know I'll probably change my mind a little bit. I'm just going to add a bit of purple in there and see how I feel about that. It's difficult when you only want to add small amounts because I don't want to get too much kind of white in the purple paint, but then I also don't want to have to keep washing my palette knife all the time. I'm also using paper because I've run out of these kind of disposable little like shot glasses for mixing paint in. But also, I do feel quite bad when I use those because it's so kind of wasteful. But it's the easiest thing for mixing several different shades of paint at once when you know that it will be really hard to clean afterwards. I think I'm going to add a little bit of yellow, and maybe I'll leave the red for now and come back to it. So I'm quite happy with that colour actually. It's kind of like a creamy kind of colour. It has some kind of depth and warmth coming through from the purple, and it's not just kind of a flat kind of light yellow, so that's kind of perfect. So I'm just going to add a drop of white spirit, which is, well, it's actually, I think, a white spirit, kind of cheap copy. And white spirit is already the kind of cheap copy of what I should be mixing these with. But I'll get that eventually. So that might have made it a little bit too wet, but we'll see how easy the lines go on. So this paint is basically, unlike a lot of other types of paint, it might even be easier to work with acrylics and things in this kind of way, but because enamel is really hard to work with, it's quite a hot day today, so it can start to dry up soon, which makes it stickier. And it gets sticky really quickly, and it's quite hard to kind of flow with the lines. But then when it's too loose, it just goes all over the place. But we'll see. I have a feeling this will be quite transparent, but I'm going to start down here. I'll try to angle it so you can see. So the thickness, it could be a little bit thicker. The dodgy angle that I'm working at, and the my attempt at not leaning over too much so I'm not in the way of the camera, it's making it a little bit more difficult to make kind of instantly straight lines. Also, this is the smallest size sign painting brush that I have, and the point of these brushes is to kind of fan out completely to their full kind of desired size as you're working. But if I were to let that happen, it would be too thick, the line it would make. So it's quite hard to control. I'm just gonna put too thick because the paint is too thin. So I think what I'll have to do is work in this way where, instead of trying to create one perfect line, I have to work in separate lines. So I'm creating a kind of smooth line down one side, but down the other it's wobbly. I'll have to patch that up. So I'm just going to go on to the second one now. Again, I'm not sure if it's because of the thinness of the paint or if I've suddenly gone camera shy, but this is one of the messiest ones I've done so far. I don't want to mess up the corners, so I'm just going to fill them in like that, rather than trying to do a nice neat twist to end it off. Try to do what a sign painter that I interviewed this summer told me, which is to kind of, I think he called it like smash out, where you kind of really work the paintbrush. So that the paint distributes evenly over it and it becomes easier to kind of work with like that. It's not distributed fully evenly, but it's better than before at least. I actually made the mistake of falling asleep last night, just after I'd finished doing one of these paintings, and I'd forgotten to kind of properly oil up this brush with neat's foot oil, which is what keeps it kind of soft and malleable. Just gonna go over that line a little, just so that it's not too kind of thin. And also the M, I'm painting it basically, but in the right way. It's not backwards, but it kind of is backwards at the same time. Because I guess because it's an M, it's difficult to see because it could be either way. But for example, if this was an F, it would look like it's backwards, and then you'll see when I turn it over that I've been working like reverse way. So this keeps happening with the bush where it, maybe you can see, where it kind of forks off. And I'm not sure if that's because I didn't apply neat foot oil to it last night. It might be a little bit annoying to work with for a little while. I'm really excited for the part with the gold and variegated leaf. It's really satisfying to watch, especially with the flakes. I did think that I read somewhere a while ago someone recommending another sign painter to keep the gold flakes because they were, there's a video of them kind of on the job using gold leaf, and I think they were blowing it all away onto the ground, like what I was doing yesterday. And someone made a kind of comment basically saying that they'd regret doing that, something like that. And I don't really think I've ever wondered or kind of realised why. And now I kind of have. They're really useful for adding another kind of element to the sign. And I realise most people aren't that fascinated by signs, but that's kind of good, I guess, because it means I can bore you to sleep with it. I always like falling asleep to someone talking about something that they're passionate about, but not necessarily something that I like know too much about. So that line was okay. I think the paintbrush is starting to get used to its kind of malleability, I guess, again. I went over a little bit, but because it's just reverse glass, it will be fine when I kind of start working on the next layer, as long as I get to it quickly. Going to start another layer, another painting, as the gold size, which is what I'll be applying in a few steps, dries. But I might do that kind of later on, because it'll be frustrating if I don't get to show the final product of that as well. but we'll see. I'm kind of not concentrating so much on this, so if you want to get nice kind of one stroke lines without repeatedly going over the same area, then you need to really kind of, well, I do anyway, need to really focus. For people that have been doing it for decades, it's probably kind of second nature to them. Which is something I kind of can't wait to find. So, almost done with the kind of beigey layer. I say almost, but probably about half. Two-thirds of the way through. And next I'll make a kind of brownish layer. It's supposed to be very warm today, so I was expecting the paint to kind of start to dry up very quickly, but I think that the sun is kind of trapped behind the clouds too much. Apologies if you keep hearing the living room door open. That's another difficult thing about working in the day. And the police sirens, of course. I can't remember if I mentioned it, but there was a time when I was filming a few videos back. And three police helicopters started circling the sky for several minutes. I've never seen that many in this area before. Only kind of on TV when they're talking about, I don't know, the O.J. Simpson case or something. So this is the last line in the cream. It's one of the hardest part about using paint like one shot is working out a way to get the texture just right so that it's not too thin, that there are kind of transparent parts. And so that it's not too sticky, but that it's not too thick, so it's kind of far too sticky to work with and not kind of flexible enough to use in the way the brush is intended. I could probably create neater lines if I kind of completely abandoned the idea of trying to create lines in as few strokes as possible. So something that I'm not succeeding at very well with this particular piece. But I really want to practice, even if the final result isn't as aesthetically nice as it could be. I really want to practice with the actual kind of techniques. Again, it's not really working this time. So that's the OT kind of beigey colour. So the inside I'm keeping empty for now. And I'm just going to add some medium brown. And I think I'll use that on this part. And then add a little bit more and use it on these parts. And a little bit more on that part. And then make quite a dark brown for the bottom two sections. And so this has made quite a nice kind of milk chocolatey kind of ice cream colour. I think if I had to name this kind of combination of colours, it would be Kinder Bueno. So I'm not going to add any more thinner, just because it was already quite thick anyway. So I'm just going to start painting this little section. My apologies for the darkness as well, the kind of shadow that I'm casting. It's just because the natural light source is behind me. And I didn't want to kind of shine a bright artificial light onto the piece. It's quite frustrating. This paint is too thin. So I keep having to go over it anyway to thicken it. I'm just going to fill this line in between the kind of cream lines. So that's that section. And now a little bit more brown. I think I probably should have shaken the brown up again. I think the last time I did was last night, which might be why it's quite thin. And so I'm just kind of scooping the top layer, which is a little bit oily anyway. These colours are making me really crave chocolate. Look exactly like the colours of the cake that my flatmates have sitting in their fridge in the kitchen. So I hope that this is still quite thin, but it's okay for working with. Now I'll just have to go over it again. Don't want to get those flakes wet. Oh, that bit's really thin for some reason. This looks a little bit like, it looks exactly like the colour of kind of Cadbury's hot chocolate. Try to fill this little corner in. I think the thinness could be a problem here because it will kind of try to bleed into the creamy colour. I've created, I think, maybe 10 so far? About 12, and then two of them I was at the final stages. Even after gold leafing, and I managed to ruin them. Okay, so I hope that this paint isn't too thin to need to mix more, because I don't want to get the next kind of batch wrong. But I only need to fill this in this one section with this colour, and then I'll probably mix up the brown a little before I start to add it to the next section, which will be for that. A little bit more up. Just going to start filling the middle in. Yeah, I think it'd be pushing it to try to get any more out of that. So hopefully just shaking it like that will get enough kind of thicker paint to the top for me to work with. And that shade looks okay now. Yeah, that's pretty much exactly the same shade. And it feels like a much better consistency as well. Yeah, this line is much, much smoother to make. It's got a little bit of kind of pull to it. A little bit of kind of resistance. But then it's still kind of, as long as there's enough paint on the brush, it still kind of glides smoothly over. So I think that's partly down to the texture being better, and partly down to the kind of flatness of the brush, because now it's nice, the bristles are nice and flat with the ferrule. I'm just going to add a little bit more of a layer onto the same section, just to kind of thicken the paint up a little. It won't be too much of a problem because I'll be applying the gold leaf on top, so it, if there are kind of transparent sections, then all that will happen is the gold leaf will kind of peek through, which isn't so bad. It could look quite nice actually. It's just still not something that I'm kind of intending for. So these shades aren't an exact kind of match, but it'll have to do. And I'm just going to add a little bit more brown for the section on that part. Keep nearly going into the gold leaf plates. I have some all over my hands, they get everywhere. So you can see how much smoother the line is to make now. And that part there. And it's satisfying when it works the way it's supposed to. Sorry if my nose is kind of in the camera. So that's how that part looks now. One of my favourite things is seeing the kind of shine, the kind of glare of a light source. And now I'm just going to start with a section of just brown by itself at the bottom, because I think that this doesn't need any other kind of lightening or anything in it. Although I might add a little bit of red just for some kind of warmth, but not necessarily to brighten the colour at all. Maybe three. Yeah, I quite like that. So it's a little bit closer to a kind of burgundy now. I think I might add another little bit of brown there. It's quite a nice shade. Just thinking whether a little bit of black or dark blue, just to make it a little bit darker, because I still want the tone of the red and the warmth to come through, but it did brighten it up a little bit more than I was hoping for. So I'm just going to add a touch of black there, because you don't need much black at all. So that's kind of back down to the original kind of colour, well, darkness of the brown from before, this time, it might not show up that well on camera, but it just has a little bit more kind of richness to it. Also, I swear I'm not filming at your shower, even though it sounds like it. This should actually be a more quiet part of the day, but... And just one more paint section, and then we get to move on to the exciting part. Although this is still, it's not exactly a chore for me. So for the actual letter, I just took the dimensions of the frame that I knew, well, the glass I knew I'd be painting, and just tried to come up with an approximate kind of margin around the sides, and then just kind of went from there and measured how big the actual letter would be, and then allowed room for kind of drop shadows. So there is the painted section of the M, and I have this handy little bottle. It used to be a hand sanitizer bottle, but I started storing my white spirit in it, and I found that instead of going to the sink every time I needed to wash a brush out, which I'm only using one brush for this part because I'm basically using the same colour and just adding a little bit more kind of like a little bit more colour to it to slightly change it. But with other pieces where I might have five or six different colours and shades on the go, I need to wash my brush a lot. So this way I can just fit this brush, and another one fits perfectly in as well, this one, and I just shake it about and then it kind of does the job really. So there's a little bit of kind of residue on this, but it'll be fine for working with. And normally I'd apply Neat's Bottle right away, but I probably will be working on another one at some point today, so I'm just going to keep that like that for now. It should be okay. And now, again, my nails aren't really practical for this purpose either. They're already really dirty. But now, I'm going to take... I'm going to see if that... I'm going to take some acrylic gold size, which is basically a glue, and now if I was applying this straight onto the front of something, then I would need perfect precision, even more precision than I just painted those sections of the letter with. But because this is reverse and the gold size, the gold leaf, sorry, is going behind the paint, I don't need to worry about it so much. So, I'm just going to generally fill in the area in between I'm going to work quite quickly so that it all kind of dries at as similar a rate as possible. And it's important to not have certain areas too much thicker than other areas. And it's also important to make sure that every single surface, every single part of the surface is covered, because if it isn't, then even if you apply a little bit, but it's such a small amount compared to the rest of the surface, then that part will dry much quicker than the rest, and the gold leaf will probably come away from it, basically. So for now, I'm just painting just that section. I'm not sure whether I should start the next one or leave it for now. I might just move that to the side as it dries, which is supposed to take around 15 minutes, and it's supposed to stay kind of workable with for several hours. But I've found that unless the gold size that I'm using is wrong or just different in some way, I found that that's completely wrong, especially if it's a hot day. It can dry within just a few minutes, and it can become kind of useless for trying to stick the gold leaf on it within maybe even 10 minutes. It might stick to some areas if it was particularly thick, but yeah, it really does depend on the kind of temperature and condition of the day. So you need to get it when, kind of like if you've ever applied like false eyelashes or maybe false nails, where the glue needs to become tacky and transparent, but you catch it just before it dries too much that it doesn't work as a glue anymore. So I guess while I'm waiting for that to dry, I'm just going to clean this little area a little. So now I'm done with those shades and they'll be dry anyway. I'm just going to turn that over, and then I'll use that section as a kind of palette now as well. I'm just going to pour some of that onto my hands and the actual desk. It's probably really, really terrible to use white spirit on your fingers and your skin, but for when you're using things like enamel paint daily, it becomes the only thing that can wash it off. Now I'm out of fairy liquid, can remove one shot from hand. I'm just going to pop. I'll need this brush in a second, it looks quite frayed and at the end of its kind of life, but it'll be okay for now. This is what actually comes with a gilding set. So its bristles are for removing the excess gold leaf. I won't need these right now, so I'm just going to pop them into a little cup. I will need this piece of paper in a moment. And these kind of palettes I'll just keep over here. An alcohol prep pad. from a first aid kit to just use to clean the area as well. So I'll just need this for the next layer of gold size, which I'll need after removing the gold size I've applied with these bristles. Probably I'll use this one first for the smaller section. So I'll just keep those here. And I'll just quickly show you the actual gold size that I'm using, gold leaf, sorry. So for this kind of colour palette, I'm thinking probably firelight variegated red leaf for the middle, which I'll just keep as it is. I'll just use the leaf as it comes. And then for the next section, I think the background, I will use silver leaf. But before I apply the silver leaf, I'm going to use the spare flakes from gold leaf, red leaf, and even a few from silver leaf, from pieces I was working on last night, to apply to the glass. So this paint takes several hours to dry. Again, it depends on temperature and conditions and humidity, of course. But because today is actually not too warm today, not like it was yesterday, and the weather lied to me. I went for a run at 8:30 and it was about maybe 19 degrees, and it said it would go up to 27, but it doesn't feel very warm in here. But it's not quite dry just yet, so I'm going to leave that to dry for a few moments, and then I'll come back to you with the type of gold leaf that we're using. Is if I applied the gold leaf at this stage, then on those areas it could kind of become a bit wrinkled. So we'll leave it for another few minutes. So I'm just going to start to sweep. Gold leaf to the glue. I'm going to start to select a piece for the glue. So I have three different types of gold leaf so far. I want to get a lot more for a different variation, and also it goes quite quickly. actually had a bit of an accident. I had a box with all of my gold leaf things in, like a tin, which I actually arrived in. But I guess one of the kind of pots that was with it tipped over and leaked, and so some of the pages stuck together. So a lot of those pages are actually still useful, but when I, for example, this is a full sheet, and luckily it's just stuck at the top, so it should be able to come apart as a full sheet, which is useful because I'll need one of those soon. But there are some, for example, that one, where it's so delicate that it's kind of fallen apart into several pieces. It's literally like you'll blow it, and you can see I'm blowing at such a tiny amount, but it flickers because it's so thin and kind of malleable. So that's the gold, imitation gold leaf. I don't feel quite deserving of real carrot, like full carrot gold leaf yet. And silver as well. So there's some partial sheets and also some, I think I have a few full ones left, but I am running out as well. And then the one that we'll be using for the glue here is, this is a partial section. So it looks like that. This one's called red variegated. So you can see. The colours are really interesting. It's kind of like a kind of, is it called tarnished? Burnished? Where it kind of looks like, it looks like a heat map almost. Or maybe tie-dye copper and kind of foil. So that's a section of it. But we'll be needing a full sheet. That's interesting because they're all unique as well. Like they're quite similar, but it's like a snowflake really. Or kind of like if you've ever seen a video of marbling, either on paper or there's a lot of videos of people marbling their guitars or their instruments. So this one looks like it might rip a little. Yeah, it's ripped a little bit in the corner. It's really easy to rip. So I don't actually have all of the tools, or the right tools yet. I don't have the squirrel hair mop for applying gold leaf. And I actually do want to get a book on gold leaf techniques, so I can start to learn some more kind of sophisticated ways. Because I use the materials, but I might not be using them fully correctly at this stage. I'm tempted to just go for it now, just because the other areas dried several minutes ago, and I'm worried they'll start to dry too much. So I'll start to prepare the sheet. So those gold leaves actually just come like I just showed you, with kind of tissue paper between them. But I had another variety, which came on wax paper, and I found that it's much easier to apply, especially if you're applying full sheets in one area. So I'm going to lay those down like that. And this is the area where I'd probably need a kind of squirrel hair mop brush to kind of kind of carry it over. So it's got a little rip there, so I might need to patch that up when it comes to the actual sheet. But I'm just going to gently kind of tap it down onto the wax. And hopefully the waxy residue has kind of stayed enough for it to be kind of transferable. So you can see how kind of floaty and delicate that is. So I want to aim for this. I'm just going to look at the comparison of how tall it is. So it should, in theory, be able to cover exactly all of it. I don't mind so much if it doesn't cover all of the paint, because that already has a cover on it. So it's basically just as long as the clear section with the glue has the gold leaf applied onto it. That's what I need. But it would be quite nice if it was all covered, because then I don't need to do anything to the back of the one shot. So I'm trying to line it up. I might not be able to speak for a bit because every kind of vibration and breath kind of moves it a little. And then I just blow on it to kind of set it. So actually it kind of covered all of it, apart from there is just a little strip at the top, which is fine. So I'm just going to blow on it very gently to kind of stick it down. And basically if I had the right kind of brush for applying it, then I'd be able to, in theory and with practice, do what I just did, but achieving no wrinkles. Obviously, we can work out the wrinkles to a certain extent, but I guess to a certain point, you can't really do anything to fix the kind of creases in it. But I'm fine with how that went on. So I'm just going to kind of lightly dab that on. I'm just going to rub very, very, very gently with my fingers. And now there's that area where there was a big extra kind of splodge of glue has kind of wrinkled a bit, but I think that if I waited much longer, this glue would have started to dry. I have a feeling some areas will probably need touching up still. And I think you're probably supposed to wait a while before you start to brush off the excess, but I really want you to see the final kind of result. So I'm just going to rip off a little corner that is excess and just apply it to the top section of the M on the left side that didn't have any gold leaf on it. And then the same with the section on the right. I'm going to tap that down. And now I'm just going to start to kind of basically chip away at the excess with the brush. So it will start to reveal the shape underneath. And this is basically how you get those extra flakes that I was talking about. And I should probably practice trying not to be so wasteful, because I probably, once I have the right materials, I'll start to kind of work at measuring it a little bit more, in a bit of a more sophisticated way, so that there's not so much kind of excess on the sides. But for now, that wasn't too bad, and actually those flakes will come in handy soon. So this part is just about getting rid of all of the excess. And there's a section just there, which is actually just where the glue was, where it hasn't stuck so well. So I'm going to hope that some of the glue has held on, and that just adding that little bit there will cover it a little. And now I'm going to just remove the clip hooks. And start to apply the glue for the final stage. Well, the final stage of how it actually looks aesthetically. Then once this is all done, I'll apply some varnish to the back as well. This is what it looks like on the back. You can see the nice kind of reflective quality. I'm just going to remove the tape and the page from the front, so we can see how it looks at the front. This stage is always this kind of scariest, because you just kind of put that work in and then it could look terrible. So I'm just going to blow away the final few bits. That's how it looks on the front. So the shades really were quite different for this section, but it doesn't look too bad. And now I'm just going to apply the final lot of glue for the background. So I've took the clip frames off so that I could work kind of right up to the edge. I just want to make sure we've got a nice smooth surface. And I'm going to take our glue, our gold sides. And if I wanted to be really wasteful, I could just apply it all over, but I'm going to try to keep it fairly kind of I don't know what the word would be. The opposite of wasteful. So that the only bits that have the gold size is the bits where we do need the background for you. So it's just on everything that's clear. And then again, I'll come back to you in a little bit when the gold size is dry. And then we'll apply the final layer and then we'll see how it looks. So this should only take a few minutes really, because I've applied it nice and thinly. So again, I'm just going to rinse out the paintbrush from the glue. It's fine to leave the paintbrush kind of wet for a little bit, but with the glue it really starts to harden the brush up quite quickly. So it's important to work quite fast so you don't waste the paintbrush, which I've done several times. And so all of that is away now. So I'm just going to lift this off and just move it to, actually I'll just fold this in half and then move it onto this so that it doesn't get, so it's not tempted to become sticky and stick down to the paper. And next time I should just need the bigger brush. I'm just going to need the scissors and probably the wax paper again. And I'll see you in a few minutes. So, I'm ready to start applying the flakes now. The glue is 99.9% dry. Dry enough to work with. But just fine for this part. So, what I would normally do at this stage is I would take it over to the edge of the desk and just kind of blow it onto the floor as I did before, but with the glass in my hand underneath. I want you to kind of be able to see it landing, so I'm just basically going to start to flake it onto the glass. So this is flakes of the gold size and the same red variegated leaf that I used for the other section. So there's some tiny, tiny flakes and then quite big sections for example when it's been like a larger chunk at the side. Like just a moment ago. So I'm going to use almost all of it, but I still want to keep some for the next letter that I'll be doing. So we've applied that, and again I'm just going to shake off that excess. So then that will be useful again. I think I'm just going to have it here as I kind of flake some up, just because the top seemed a little bit kind of empty. And just one on the bottom. So now you can see all of the flakes. And I'm just going to put that to the side. And now it's going to apply the final layer of, I always call it gold leaf, but obviously as today shows, there are plenty of different colour variations. So I want to apply some silver onto that. I'm just going to select a nice silver sheet where there's plenty to work with. This one seems perfect for one of the sections. It's bent over a little bit there, so I might not be able to save that section, but I'll try. I think it might be pink. No, I think I've saved it. There we go. So we're going to move that to the side. I'm actually going to just put it onto the wax over there. I'm going to try to line it up, hopefully as close to the bottom as I can. And just gently press it down so it kind of sticks onto the wax. I'm just going to move the glass back onto this sheet and take that silver leaf and apply it onto, I think the best area will be the bottom section. So if I line it up perfectly with the bottom of this paper, then I'll know where it is. So that is on there. And the way that the wax works is basically now I can actually use that to press it down instead of having to just blow it down and then kind of be more careful with the paintbrush. Now I can actually use the wax as a kind of means of pressing it. And I need to find another silver sheet. So I think that's a full one. Just here. I think this might be a few. I'm actually going to take this and just apply another piece of tissue paper over it so that I can use the scissors to cut a smaller strip so there's slightly less waste. I still can't be as not wasteful as I'd like to be because I'm not as kind of able to be as, what the word be, I can't narrow the amount of silver leaf down as much as I would like because I'm not that kind of good at it yet. I just tried sticking it down to the wax on the wrong side. So now it's on the wax again. And again, I'm just going to move it up to the edge of the paper, just so I know where it meets. And I'm just going to use the wax to apply it. It wasn't stuck down as well as I hoped. It doesn't actually stick to the wax, it just gives it a kind of attraction to it. So I should be able to cover all of that section with this. So you really, the wax is useful for this because you really need to rub it down so it can get around those kind of nooks and crannies where the gold and variegated leaf I applied before was. So that's another way that the wax is useful. If I was using a paintbrush for this, it would be a little bit too rough. And I'm just going to use the wax again. And I'm going to apply it there. And just press down. And then we have just one section to go, which, to be honest, I probably could cover with the excess, but all of these are looking fairly unwrinkled, so I want to try to keep it as kind of flat as possible. So then just one final section, which we have here. So there it is. On the wax. I've got a little bit here, which I'll just put to the side. Plant that there, and then there'll be a big lot of excess from the side of it that I can just probably lift up and carry into the one remaining tiny section we've got in the middle. So if I just pull, then we've got this bit here, which should cover that perfectly. Oh. Hopefully it is sticky enough, because even though this kind of new thing I have where I apply the flakes first and then the main colour is a really nice kind of aesthetic idea, it can kind of compromise with how well the main colour kind of sticks. I'm just going to put those pieces back there and the spare pieces on the top, because I found that they come in quite in handy. And I'm just going to press down with the wax one final time. Now I'm going to start pushing away at the sides. Now I really hope I haven't done what I did yesterday, which was I did all of this and I turned it over and I realised that I'd done the final layer of gold leaf on the wrong side. So basically I lost the piece. So what happens here is the same thing as the first time we removed the gold leaf, but obviously there's going to be some other parts where the flakes landed first, because this is basically smoothing it out. But we don't want to be too rough with it, because then it can scratch through onto the front layer, which is something we don't want. I'm just going to brush over the sides. So now, for when I'm working on my next piece, I have all of these flakes left over from the silver. So I might do a gold leaf background with silver flakes, and then I will also have some variegated pieces from before. I'm just going to move those to the side. Now I'm teasing you here, you won't get to see the final thing just yet. And bear in mind, I have no idea how it looks. It might be terrible. I hope not. But I could always take the sketches into Photoshop or whatever and start to work with testing various colour themes and variations, but I like to just kind of do it how I feel. So now I'm going to, obviously, before I kind of do anything with this, I'm going to come back to it and apply varnish. That's an important step. But for now, just to see how it looks, I want to put it in back in the clip frame. And I'm just going to take some tissue paper and just work it over the front of the glass so that it's hopefully nice and clean. With a little bit of white spirit. It does the same kind of job as lettering. And if I turn it over and it's a disaster, then I'm very sorry. But hopefully, that'll be nice. So, are you ready? So my battery on my camera just ran out just before I was about to finish the video. But here's the final result. So I'm quite happy with it. Obviously there's some imperfections. Like with the glue, it's a little bit too thick in certain areas. Trying to get it at some nice kind of angles so that you can see how different kind of angles of light kind of highlight the flakes and the shine. So there's the red variegated leaf in the centre and red and gold silver just behind it. So yeah, quite happy with it. That's something like 11 down, and many more to go. Thank you for watching, and if you've made it all the way through this process, then I'll be very surprised, but thank you for being patient. Hope you enjoyed.